Wonderful to see you again. And it is May 2013. As I said, this is the month that people are going to realize, uh-oh, it's here. Trouble is here. And this is therefore the month that we need to provide the true remedy, the real remedy, which is, first of all, we have to have a solution to the continuity problem. Now, I tell you this, that if there were not a continuity problem at all of us would instantly drop this entire hypothetical scenario we call existence and wake up to the reality that is. We wouldn't hesitate at all. Nobody would. That's how much we like existence. That's how much we like time. Yeah. That's how much we love time. We drop it instantly. The only issue that keeps us embracing time, clinging to time, because we imagine it's clinging to us because we don't want to realize that we could let it go. So we don't want to realize we're the ones who are grabbing all the time. The reason why is the continuity problem. That is why we cling to time. all right. Just looking at all the activity that's going on around here. We cling to time because of that. That's it. Continuity problem. So any spiritual teaching to be effective has to focus in on the continuity problem, which is what we do here. So I spent my time on my life. What is the problem here? The continuity problem is the problem. And I have devised this affirmation which will enable us to solve the continuity problem. When you spend your time on the spiritual path, how are you spending it? You should be spending it on dissolving the continuity problem, lessening it. That will provide the success that you see all of that what's happening in the world, and you know there's so much happening in the world now, it's almost like you can't react to all of it. There's too much of it. It's too shocking to even react to anymore. Is necessary in relationship to the idea of wanting to be prime creator, of spirit wanting to displace the prime creator and become a new prime creator. All of time, everything that's happening we call time and existence, is a direct effect of this idea that spirit is entertaining of wanting to be prime creator. All of it. And this scenario of impermanence that we call existence, of gradual loss, an assembly line of sacrifice, of everything that is born to die, that is directly the effort to defend against a mental condition I call total mental chaos, which is the way that mind symbolizes annihilation. Because spirit wanting to be prime creator, that desire, that idea, would necessitate the annihilation of reality. So how does mind presents ideas to spirit? Spirit chooses ideas, mind presents them. So how does mind present the idea of the annihilation of reality, which is really what spirit is asking for? Because reality is one indivisible whole. So mind has to present it as total mental chaos. And then that experience is intolerable to abide in for spirit. Can only momentarily experience it and recoil, reject it. So how does mind keep it going? By saying, oh, but before there was this total mental chaos, prior to it, as a precursor, there's all this temporary chaos, temporary loss. Annihilation means total loss. So before total loss was a gradual, partial loss happening slowly, not totally. So this is really an attempt, this dream of existence, is an attempt to limit loss. It's a dream of limited loss. So that's why we have birth, bodies are born, they die, bodies are just symbols of loss, way of symbolizing some vulnerability to loss. Everything we see is just a mental projection of vulnerability to loss. And but the loss happens gradually. We're born, we grow, we age, we die. New people come into the world, new things are being born constantly, and they're growing, aging, dying. And it's a cycle, continuous cycle, limiting loss. It's a necessary defense against the experience of total mental chaos. Okay, so you cannot have the idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator without spirit identifying with this crazy dream of impermanence. It's absolutely necessary, unavoidable. However, spirit is perfectly free to choose a new idea and say, wait a minute, this one isn't working out for me. I want to choose, how about if I choose the idea of I don't want to be prime creator. What would that give rise to? You see, well, that certainly wouldn't give rise to, mind would not have to present annihilation to spirit, and therefore mind would not have to present a defense against, wouldn't have to symbolize it as a total mental chaos and then present a defense against that, experiencing that, which would be total loss. It wouldn't have to do that. All it would have to do is say, well, what if reality couldn't be changed? I wouldn't need to change anything. I wouldn't need to defend against anything. I could accept everything exactly the way it is. So that feeling of completeness, of not needing to do anything, is completeness. No time is necessary for this. Nothing has to happen. You see, in that idea, nothing has to be defended against. No gradualism is necessary. No time is necessary. No process is necessary. So you could, it has the feeling of completeness right now. So that feeling of completeness and no loss right now is called bliss, or timeless bliss, just bliss. We can actually experience bliss right here in this dance of impermanence, because bliss is an overlay, as it were. It's saying this, all this impermanence does not change how I feel at all, does not change how this feels at all. It has no effect upon it. So we can get from one hypothetical scenario, one dream of impermanence, to a dream of permanence, as it were, without getting rid of the forms of impermanence. We can get to that through working on the continuity issue, and how we do that is called affirmations. And we say, this form of gradual loss we call totalitarianism, all right, does not cause my spirit to feel this, to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. This form of gradual loss we call totalitarianism does not cause my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. So we are conceptually practicing what-if-ism, like what if this were the case? We're practicing it conceptually. Then, and after we do that, comes the feeling of what if gradual loss wasn't taking place right now, wasn't affecting the feeling of completeness right now, could not affect it in any way right now. And we get the feeling of that, which is called bliss. So as we are watching the end of civilization, we know it. We got front row seats to it right now. That's why probably there's 7 billion people on the planet. It's like some super movie that's taking place, and everybody wanted to come and watch this movie. So the aisles are packed, all the seats are full, and the aisles are standing room only. 7 billion people on the planet, and we're all got our popcorn, and we're watching the end of civilization as we know it here on this planet. So instead of reacting to everything it takes, we can simply say, ah, this form of gradual loss we call fascism is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. This form of gradual loss we call the collapse of civilization is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. And so we remain peaceful and calm and serene and blissful. We pave the way for bliss that way. Because it really is only a movie. Remember, it's a movie necessary to defend against spell chaos. So no way are we criticizing that fact at all. So we're not saying you guys are bad, or you guys are wrong, or you should stop it. We are just affirming that we're not feeling it at all. We're not feeling the gradual loss at all. We're not feeling the incompleteness at all. Our spirits are completely free of any of that feeling. But we're acknowledging, we're not attacking anyone, anything that anyone's doing. We're acknowledging that the play of impermanence, the play of time, is taking place, and it's okay. Because it's necessary to defend against mental chaos. So that's the compassionate, loving, spiritual approach to the entire situation. We're just saying that we're choosing a different idea, and therefore we're not experiencing the slightest bit of gradual loss, the slightest bit of incompleteness. We're not experiencing at all, not even the slightest bit. So this is the right way to go about it. You're not in opposition to anyone or anything, because truly the dance of time is a necessity in relationship to the idea of wanting to be prime creator. It is a necessity. And so all this stuff, this craziness that's happening, that's part of the dance of time. That's how time is dancing right now. And we don't have to figure out all the bizarre mechanisms of time, and because we're not feeling any of it. Bliss doesn't feel any of it. The effects of another idea don't experience any sort of gradual loss, any sort of incompleteness. Absolutely not. So it's supremely helpful at this time. You know, I say, if I could say anything to Jesus or any great teacher, Ananda Mahima, I'd say, get yourselves here right now, you know. what are you waiting for? Really? Seriously? Well, what they could be waiting for is for us to have a conceptual framework to handle the fact that they would be here. And the sun has just gone boom. And now the clouds are back. It's one of those days. Maybe they're waiting so that we have a conceptual framework. But the fact is, now we do have one. This affirmation is the conceptual framework that we can utilize to have a perfectly awakened, to have someone here who is in the timeless, blissful condition. Because we know how to practice now, you see. We know how to practice. We know how to spend, quote-unquote, time with them. We won't be all in focus like, hey, what do you think about this or that? No. We say, hey, help us practice. Help us, motivate us to practice more. That is the real goal. Like a basketball coach, they don't teach people basketball so much. They motivate them to practice and play better, and how to play better. But you got to start with basketball players. So you get like a top coach in the NBA. They have players, and they're saying, this is how we get the most out of the players, and they're motivating them to play their best. So really top-notch teachers motivate you to practice and be your best. Do the best you can at practicing and preparation. So all I'm doing is I'm concretizing this basic form of affirmation, which should open the door for some of those who are in the state of timelessness, in the mind, mental state, and spiritual experiencing the bliss of timelessness, to show up here in this world and say, okay, folks, there really is a collapse of civilization that's happening, but you don't have to experience that. You really don't have to experience it. It's not causing the collapse of what you're feeling at all. Your spirit, my spirit, the form of gradual loss we call collapse of civilization is not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. It's not causing my spirit in any way to feel gradual loss right now. You see that? So we literally would not be feeling it or experiencing it at all. It's not causing the slightest problem for timelessness and completeness, etc. Because that comes from a different idea. It's the effect of a different idea. But we need to segue over into that idea. To solve the continuity issue, the bridge, to bridge it, to go across a bridge. So the affirmation is the bridge. Practicing it is crossing the bridge. And once the bridge is crossed, easy to dwell in bliss. Those who have been here in the world dwelling in bliss, it's easy for them. They're asked, is it a problem, inconvenience? And they say, no, not at all, not at all. It's completely effortless. It's never a problem. Nothing disturbs my peace. Nothing disturbs my bliss. Nothing disturbs my feeling of completeness. I don't feel the slightest bit of loss, gradual loss, at all. And we marvel at that. But that's just simply the effects of a different idea than what we're experiencing. It's not that they have the same idea that we do and are somehow managing to be blissful. Not at all. They've chosen a different idea and they're experiencing the effects of it. They're able to come here in this world because it's the effect of overlaying all these forms that we have used for the play of gradual loss. They're able to come here. They're absolutely able to come here. And we're able to understand them very well. They're just saying, yeah, I see all this gradual loss, but I'm not feeling gradual loss in the slightest bit right now. So this form of gradual loss we call, and then we name all this, whatever we want comes to our mind, is not causing my spirit to feel gradual loss in any way right now. You can say it, not causing my spirit in the slightest, in any way to feel gradual loss right now. It's not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit gradual loss right now. Or it's not causing my spirit to feel gradual loss in any way right now. You know, either way. Whatever you'll do it one way and then you'll do it another way. And just, yeah, it's all good. It's all basic. There's no test to say what form are you using. No, nothing like that. So I've said that May is a crucial month, and it is. What's going on in the world is a farce. It is a farce, really. And if it weren't so tragic, it'd be funny. But we can say, look, this. The form of gradual loss we call a farce is not causing my spirit to feel in any way. It's not causing my spirit to feel gradual loss in any way right now. This form of gradual loss we call a farce is not causing me to feel gradual loss in any way right now. Not causing my spirit to feel gradual loss in any way right now. This form of gradual loss we call a farce is not causing my spirit to feel gradual loss in any way right now. This is an affirmation that paves the way for bliss. Plug and pave. Easy to plug anything into this formula. It's a more important formula than all the formulas the scientists figure out. You know, the chemical formulas of how to do this and this chemically and with physics and all that stuff. No, this is way more important than that. This enables you to solve a continuity problem to choosing a new idea and literally then being able to set down all what hypothetical dreams together and abide in reality, which we've never really left. But we are imagining that we have left. So you can have all the scientific formulas that have ever been made from all the heavyweights of history, you name them, all of them. I'll take this one formula over all of those others. Absolutely. The form of gradual loss that we call the loss of freedom is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. Okay? The form of gradual loss, which we call the loss of freedom, is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. That is the equation. The form of gradual loss that we call the loss of civil rights is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. You see, this is segueing over to a new idea and the effects of a new idea, which is bliss, timeless bliss. We're not fighting against anything in existence. We're just saying, look, yes, whatever's happening, it's okay, because in no way does it cause my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. Let's call it affirmation. It's the ultimate equation. Feels like a winter day right now. Yesterday it was the middle of August. Today it's February. Wow. It's got my tomatoes scratching their heads, that's for sure. What do we do? What do we do? What do we do? It's been the go time the last week. 90s, mid-90s. And now it's mid-60s, and the tomatoes are saying, well, what's going on? I said, grow. Come on. It'll warm up again. So, we have this equation. And don't waste your time on scientific equations. What you need is spiritual equations. This form of gradual loss we call scientific equations is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. All right? You can say that. I just said it. This form of gradual loss we call scientific equations is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. And what's the underlying of feeling? Peace, bliss, smooth, harmony, quiet, stillness, mental stillness, an untroubled state of mind. But if we don't do these affirmations, your mind is going to be very troubled. And we certainly don't want that for anybody here, for anyone. Again, all of this rigmarole of existence is a necessity in relationship to wanting desire to be prime creator, but we don't have to have that desire to be prime creator. We can repent, meaning we can change our mind about it. We can say, you know what, that was a crazy, eccentric, whimsical idea on my part. I was just pure whim. I said, what the heck, let me just try this. It was just whimsical. There's no harm, no foul. God is not angry, God is not threatened. It's just, everything continues on as always. Everything in reality is the same. It's just that we are engaging in this eccentricity of pretending that we can be prime creator. But it entails this horrible bondage to time and the dance of impermanence, the dance of temper, of gradual loss. In relationship to this idea, will always be there in relationship to this idea. In other words, we cannot have the idea of wanting to be prime creator without experiencing this terrible assembly line of sacrifice we call time, of gradual loss to defend against total mental chaos. We cannot have our cake and eat it too. It will always be a necessary defense. The mental chaos will always be there, and a defense against it will always be this gradual loss. There's no way around that. No way around that. All we do is we try to figure out, well, who's going to lose right now? Maybe we can avoid loss for a little while longer and someone else, push somebody else into loss or something. It's a dance of loss. It's a dance of limiting loss, gradual loss. So what we have to do is we have to choose a new idea. We have to choose once again. We have to exchange hypothetical scenarios, exchange belief systems, as whatever you want to call it. And we can do that, except the continuity issue has to be worked through. So that's what we're doing. This equation, affirmation, is a spiritual equation and enables us to work through the continuity problem. Because conceptually, we can rehearse already being aware that our spirit is that all this gradual losses in the world, all this stuff, is not causing our spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. We can get familiar and comfortable with that conceptually, and then the feeling, the experience, the full experience can come in. The door is open. In other words, we open the door and let the breeze come in. If our doors are all shut, won't come in, can't come in. It's a subtle thing. It's a subtle change. So, the spiritual equation of affirmation is the way to solve the continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that's really an obstacle for us. Once we solve this continuity problem, we won't have a sense of obstacles. And we have been told way ahead of time that we would come upon these times now that we're in right now. I've been warning about them my whole life, and many have been warning about them prior to that, and way prior to that. And many, many voices saying, hey, the dance of time is going to dance in this way coming up soon. It's going to, you know, be boogieing down Broadway in this particular way. And so you're probably not going to like it very much. So you better prepare to choose a new idea. In other words, you better start working on the continuity issue. Yeah, because all this stuff is boogalooing down Broadway. And we say, man, I just can't dance that way. I don't have the moves to dance like that. Yeah, so a lot of us don't feel like dancing that way. So we need to solve the continuity, work on the continuity issue, so we can choose a new idea and be completely undisturbed by the dance of time, dance of impermanence, dance of sacrifice, dance of limiting loss, gradual loss, dance of incompleteness. We can first be completely free of it and how we feel. It does not disturb how we feel in the slightest bit. And then ultimately we can be free of it by setting it down entirely and not even needing to pay the slightest attention to whatever form the dance takes. It's as if nothing is recognized as nothing. Reality doesn't have a past. There is no past to reality. There's no precursor to reality. There's no gap between cause and effect. There is never has been, never will be. So it's really nothing. But right now, we just simply need to say, well, we recognize that it's an attempt at something, and it's just that this attempt at something is not affecting how we feel in the slightest bit. So that's sufficient. So we're targeting May to move forward, and we are moving forward. May is the make or break month for sure. As a matter of fact, today is the fifth day of May, and that's a big day. And this is when the equation has been given out. I taped earlier today, the 5th of May, this equation. I haven't posted it yet. I will post it maybe this evening. And then maybe I'll post this one on the 6th. I'm taping this on the 5th of May. I always said the 5th day of the 5th month of 2013 will be the critical day, and it's turned out to be so. I was able to get this equation all smooth and refined and polished and get it out to you. Share it with the world. And on that very day also, we became aware that the entire Constitution of the United States and Bill of Rights, etc., has been stood on its head upside down, that we're all guilty until proven innocent here now, according to the authorities, you know, the quote-unquote, the people wearing the uniforms, get up in the morning and wear a uniform, which many of us do, different types of uniforms. Go to work, put on a suit, put on some work clothes. Hey, throw that leaf over there, etc. So anyway, we've been informed that we're all guilty until it's up to us to prove our innocence now. No habeas corpus, indefinite detention for everybody. Wonderful. So this is May 5th. Welcome to Cinco de Mayo. And so we say, hey, that's okay. This form of gradual loss we call May 5th is not causing my spirit to feel in any way gradual loss right now. It's not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. This form of gradual loss that we call turning the Bill of Rights upside down is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. And so how do you feel? Smooth. Calm and smooth. Non-reactive. Now, if you didn't have this equation, how are you going to feel? You're probably going to feel very reactive, which you certainly don't want, because this is just the beginning. And you're going to become more and more reactive, which you certainly don't want to become that way, because it gets harder and harder to get back your calm. It's not like things are going to return to the way they used to be. They will not. So where are you going to get your sense of calm except with spiritual clarity, with affirmation equation? This plug and pave the road to bliss. That's where you get your calm. That's where you get your non-reactivity. Now, you're not being a good little sheep or anything. No, you're crossing the bridge to a new idea. You're saying, hey, this old idea just doesn't cut it anymore. You know, never did cut it, but now it really doesn't. I just don't have the moves to dance with it anymore. I don't have those dance moves, so time to move on to a different idea. Very simple. And again, not judging anyone who continues on, because if they want to continue to try to be prime creator, it's necessary for them to continue on with the dance of time. It's necessary. There's no way around it. So they're just doing what they got to do to keep on dancing with time. You know, they're engaged in a dance with time and impermanence and gradual loss. And so this dance is getting really weird, and they're dancing really weird, doing all sorts of weird, you know, dance moves, which we've seen recently, you know, all the really weird dance moves that come around. And they have to keep dancing as long as they want to try and be prime creator, which, you know, as long as they want to continue to be totally eccentric, hey, knock yourself out. It's just that we decided, hey, no, we'll choose a different idea. So we're working on the continuity issue here, because we're not good at dancing that way. We don't want to keep dancing that way. I think we've slipped our sacroiliac, you know, and so we just I got a bad back. I can't dance that way anymore. Hey, a lot of us aren't very good dancers at all anyway, right? So that's easy call. I've never been a good dancer with time, you know, so to speak. Or at least I thought I used to be, but now I'm thinking, nah, I never really was very good at all. It was very clumsy. It's always clumsy. Time is a clumsy dance, for sure. It's never elegant. So we apply the formula. The form of gradual loss we call clumsiness is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. So we woke up the May 5th and we found out, oh, we're all citizens are wards of the state, actually. We're only born here to serve the state. So, oh, wow, interesting. So, this form of gradual loss we call enslavement to the state is not causing my spirit in the slightest bit not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. This form of gradual loss we call enslavement to the state is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. Simple, easy. You see, there's no reactivity to it. Because we're crossing a bridge and we're looking back from where we're leaving and just saying, auf Wiedersehen, darling. Adios. Sayonara. Vaya con Dios. Bye bye. Not hating on anyone, not judging on anyone, etc. Just stating the fact that, where I'm going, all the stuff over there is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. That's all. That's all. And we have to be aware that the dance of time gets really crazy at certain times and places. And of course, we can tick off the examples, one after the other. Here, already in the 20th century, how many times has it already happened the dance gets really crazy? And everybody, wants to dance that way. At least time, see, time is leading in this idea, the 1B Prime Creator. Time takes the lead, is the lead dancer. It's the one doing the lead in the dance, and you're just the one following. And sometimes time dances crazy, and so we're following in a, crazy manner, like, whoa, what is this dance? It's making our head go around, terrible, terrible, terrible stuff. And then afterwards we say, wow, I hated that dance. It was just horrible. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? So it's always good to know in advance the crazy dance is coming to pass so that you can plug in and pave the road to bliss through the spiritual equation of this form of gradual loss we call dot, dot, dot is not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. See? Crossing the bridge, paving the road to bliss. So it's all good. No worries. I know a lot of people are reacting right now. But what can I say? I have to tell them the truth. That's not the way. Reactivity is not the way. Because time will continue to dance. As long as you have the desire to be Prime Creator, you are in a dance with time, and time is leading. And you may say, hey, I don't like this dance. I want to lead. It's not possible. Because time is defending you against the experience of mental chaos, total mental chaos. And so time will tell you, hey, if you don't want me to lead, you're going to lead yourself right into total mental chaos. Which is, that's what would happen. And that's a lot worse than what the dance that time is doing, as terrible as it is. So you will end up following the lead of time, whether you like it or not. And that dance gets really very nasty. Dance, very terrible dance. So the way is to plug in this spiritual equation into your life. And just do it. Just do it. Yeah. I don't know if that saying is copyrighted or not. Probably trademarked. Just do it. But just go for it then. We'll just go. Plug and pave. There you go. Plug and pave. Plug in this spiritual affirmation, this spiritual equation affirmation, and pave the road to bliss. Very simple. Solve the continuity issue for yourself. If you just try it, you will find that your upset is gone. Say, where's my upset? Oh, I don't feel any upset. I feel kind of a sense of humor. And I feel humorous, like smiling and laughing. Not over anything in particular, but just because of a sense of, hey, I'm getting free of this. Isn't that great? Time thought it would, make me dance forever, but it's not. And again, no attack on time either at all. it's mind is presenting time. Mind is presenting this imaginary past, this imaginary precursor to reality, to experiencing an effect. See, when we choose ideas, in reality, we choose an idea, the experiencing of the idea, which is the effect of the idea, is instantaneous, simultaneous, instantaneous. There's no gap. But what mind is saying, has to say now is, no, there's a big gap. Before you experience total mental chaos, there's this time, there's this long, long sojourn, this journey. We're on a long journey through time, the endless journey through time. Prior to experiencing the effect. But in reality, there's no such thing as a gap between cause and effect. No gap whatsoever. Nor need there be, because reality is completely invulnerable. Nothing bad can ever happen. So there's no reason to postpone an effect of an idea, except this whimsical idea of wanting to be prime, greater, wanting to annihilate reality. We literally can't experience it except by bringing in time. So it's not like we're trying to avoid real annihilation. It's just simply in order to experience this idea, we have to bring time into the picture, a precursor prior to this effect of total mental chaos. So don't blame anybody. Don't get mad at anybody. Don't hate on anybody. There, when you see your brother and sister dating crazy now, as they are, you just realize that it's time that's doing the leading. They're just following the dance. They're holding tight to their dance partner, which is time, and time is just moving them around and like, whoa, like say, wow, that's a crazy step there. Whoa, don't go over there, you know, don't dance over there. They're dancing over there, dancing in the dark for sure. And so don't go there. You say, it's time that's leading, okay? It's time that's leading, not your brother and sister, so to speak, in spirit. They're following, and they're desperately clutching time, because for them, it's either hold fast to time or experience total mental chaos, because they don't realize they can choose a new idea. They're still feel they're stuck with this idea of trying to be prime creator, and they're not stuck. They're ignorant of this fact. So this affirmation is like a new dance partner. You know, you can look at it that way too, a new dance partner. So this form of gradual loss we call time is not causing my spirit the slightest bit, not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. Looks like it's going to rain or something. Whew. Yesterday I went out and bought a watermelon. That's how hot it was. Literally, I said, man, this is August. I got to buy a watermelon. And now it's like chilly and overcast and cool. So I don't think I can eat a watermelon today. It's going to have to warm up again. So we have this equation now, the spiritual equation, new dance partner. Start dancing with this new dance partner, that's all. You know, just dozy-do your partner and grab this new, the spiritual equation, this new dance partner. That's what's going to help you, is to practice it. Don't grab a hold of some other person or anything. Grab a hold of the equation, because it's something you can practice constantly, all the time, in any situation. Anything is grist for this mill, anything you come across. In the prior video to this, I gave a vast array of examples of this. So happy Cinco de Mayo, everybody. It's the day that we found out what's really going on here. How time is going to start dancing now in the future. We get it. We get it. If we haven't already. But what's happening is people are reacting instead of using the spiritual equation of this is not this form of gradual loss we call loss of freedom is not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. So it's not causing my spirit to feel in even the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. This is affirming the new idea that we're choosing, that idea of not trying to be prime creator. A what if? That's a what if. What if we could not be prime creator? See, because choosing to be prime creator is a what if. It's saying, what if we could be prime creator? Because we can't. So we can't really, it's not an idea like to say, I am prime creator. We cannot, can't change reality. So it's a what if. So it's a hypothetical. It's not really an idea. It's the idea of hypotheticalness, really. Which, so we, the idea of what if I weren't, couldn't become prime creator is also hypothetical. Because in reality, we don't need to have such an idea because we already, reality is the way it is. We don't have to have that idea to be, for reality to be the way it is. So it's a what if. So it's expressed hypothetically. In imagination, spiritual, the mind uses imagination as a what if. Imagination means what if, right? When we imagine something, like what if this island was made of candy, you know? That kind of thing. What if there's an island made of all candy? That's a what if. What if the moon was made of cheese? It's just simply our imagination. So we say, what if there was all this impermanence, this dance of impermanence, dance of gradual loss? And then we can say, well, what if there wasn't? What if there wasn't any gradual loss? But this can be purely on the feeling, experiencing level. We don't have to get rid of the forms that. It's like you don't have to get rid of your body in order to pay no attention to your shadow, okay? Let's say you don't like your shadow. Let's say your shadow really bugs you. Say, I don't like my shadow. Well, just stop paying attention to it. You don't have to get rid of your body so there's no shadow. You can say, well, I don't have to look at my shadow, right? As a matter of fact, I never pay attention to my shadow. I can't even think of the last time I paid attention. Well, I can actually. I was taking a photograph, and my shadow was in the photograph, so I had to reposition the camera so the sun wasn't casting my shadow in the photograph. But other than that, I never pay any attention to my shadow or shadows of anything, really. We tune it out. We don't have to pay it. We don't have to. Just because they're all this form of impermanence here doesn't mean we have to imagine that we're feeling gradual loss from all this. We don't have to, because it's all imagination anyway. I'm just letting the play of this leaf play, because that's all part of existence here anyway, but I'm just, you know, ignoring it. Doesn't have to cause me to feel anyway at all. But literally, from this other hypothetical, we say, what if I wasn't prime creator? What if I just am what I am, spirit? Is this no need for any defensiveness, no need for any gradual loss to defend against any feeling of mental chaos at all? None, no need. So we can simply imagine all of this saying, well, what if it doesn't cause me to feel any gradual loss at all right now? See? We're entirely entitled to that. But the important thing is to practice the affirmation and feel it for yourself. Don't look for results. Just practice it, and you will feel subtly, you'll say, hey, I'm not as reactive as I was before. Obviously, you won't be. Because you'll be focused on this formula, equation, and doing that, and your reactivity, where is it? It's nowhere, really. I was looking at the news today and seeing all the news and just, oh my gosh, you know, here we go. Here we go. And they said, whoops, I better plug in this equation here. And now, do I feel any upset now about it? No, I don't. But before, I was starting to feel all this reactivity. I said, no, that's not right. Let's use the equation here. Now it does get easier as you get older, because you're not so prone to, you don't have so much energy and reactivity and emotion, etc. It's easier to do this when you're younger. It is more difficult. There's no question about it. Youth has to be raised correctly, in a right society, etc., or it becomes very difficult for them. It's too easy for them to become reactive, unfortunately. But it's not impossible if you, to use the if you use the equations, you will calm down for sure. But what happens is you say, "Well, I'll do both. I'll do both," and that's not the right answer. Because again, time is doing the leading in this dance. Now, youth thinks that it can turn the tables and it can outdance time. It cannot outdance time. All right, I used to think I could outdance time. We naturally, when we're young, we feel we can outdance anything. You cannot outdance time. If you realize that time is a dance to avoid total mental chaos, you realize you cannot outdance time. Because if you do, you'll experience total mental chaos, and that's intolerable. And take it from me who tried to outdance time and experience total mental chaos. It is completely intolerable for anyone. Nobody ever will be able to tolerate it in the slightest degree. So don't try to outdance time. Instead, switch dance partners. Okay? And yet the temptation to try to outdance time is very severe when you're young. I understand that. But right now, you can't really afford to dabble in that kind of stuff. It's a very foolish thing to do. So you have to make a decision. Are you going to be extremely foolish and blame it on your youth? And get this, time doesn't care about your excuses, right? Time could absolutely care less about your excuses. You can't just say, "Oh, well, I was young and dumb at that time," and well, too bad. Time doesn't care. It keeps dancing. So you can't make any excuses. You can't say, "Well, I'm just young, so it has to, time has to forgive me of that." No, it will not. Make a decision. Say, "No, I'm going to play this one smart for once. I don't care how young I am. It doesn't matter. I'm going to play this one smart because I know now's the time to be smart, and I can be." And then plug in this spiritual equation. And say, I'm not going to try to outdance time, okay? I'm going to switch dance partners." And you can do that. Anybody can do it. And you can make a decision. It's a fundamental decision that you make. And don't be afraid of making it. Because those who are also making the decision will respect you just like they respect themselves. Your age doesn't matter at all. Anybody who makes this decision is has got all the respect in the world from everybody else who makes this decision. It's got nothing to do with age. It has to do with wisdom. It's like Ramana Maharshi deciding, "Okay, I'm not going to go along with this whole death paradigm of the world anymore. I'm not going to spend my whole life worrying about death," etc. He says, "I'm going to experience it right now." When he's like, what, 16 or something, he just lay down in his room and said, "Okay, death, come on, right now. Let's get it over with right now. I want to know what there is beyond death and what death really does to me right now." And then this feeling came over him like death, and he couldn't move. He was completely rigid, like he was dead. And then he realized, "No, this death doesn't touch me. This is all just a mirage, a facade." And it was over for him. You see, the jig was up, the dance time was up right then and there. He said, "He's not saying he's not going to go along with it. Just because he's young doesn't mean he said, 'Oh, I got a whole lifetime before I try to deal with this.'" He said, "No, let's deal with it right now." So, nobody has to string it out for a lifetime of gradual loss. They can decide right now, "Hey, time to plug in this equation, spiritual equation, right now." Because really, we don't have a lifetime left together here with time. Time is going to start dancing a very crazy dance. It's going to start dancing upside down, is what time is going to start doing. And that is no fun for anybody. And it's not meant to be fun. You see, defending against total mental chaos is a serious business. It's not meant to be fun. And it's meant to be extremely brutal, actually. Time will literally do anything to avoid that total mental chaos. Anything at all. Global catastrophes. You name it. Massive destructions, massive, terrible loss, every torture, trauma, whatever. Any of that, time will utilize any and everything to stay away from that experience of total mental chaos. And I totally understand that, having been there. Anything is preferable than total mental chaos. Any experience is preferable, by far and away. And so time will bring all that stuff to you. It'll dance all that dance into your experiencing. If you keep time as a dance partner, it will most certainly do it. There's no question about it at all. Guaranteed it will do that. So, switch dance partners. You don't have to get a guru for a dance partner, new dance partner. You don't have to, you know, get the equation, the spiritual equation of affirmation is a new dance partner. Now, gurus can motivate us. Saints, sages, gurus can motivate us. But they're not the dance partner. It's the spiritual equation. The affirmation is solves the continuity issue. They're motivators. They say, go for it. Come on. Don't wait. Don't keep dancing with time. That's bad dance partner. Switch dance partners right now. And stick with it. And then they encourage us because we see, I want to be like them. Because they're in bliss. And they're not troubled at all by this dance of time. They're seeing it, but they're not troubled by it. Doesn't touch how they feel at all. Doesn't touch them. Doesn't disturb their peace of mind the slightest bit. So we can change dance partners, absolutely. So this form of temporary loss that we call dancing upside down is not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit gradual loss right now. It's not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. So we can remain where we are for now in the world and be undisturbed by what is taking place. We can also at some point shift, if we need to be, shift to another place. If the dance of time gets even more out of control. So the form of temporary loss that we call draconian laws does not cause my spirit to feel in the slightest bit gradual loss right now. This form of gradual loss we call draconian laws is not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit gradual loss right now. It's not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit gradual loss right now. This form of gradual loss we call draconian laws is not causing my spirit to feel in the slightest bit gradual loss now. So where is the outrage? Where is the upset? It's not there. Because we're stating, it's not causing my spirit to feel any gradual loss in the slightest bit right now. And if we're not feeling any gradual loss in the slightest bit, we're not feeling any sense of incompleteness at all, where's the outrage? Where's the upset? No, absolutely not. And we're not going to feel it for others' sake because we're showing them the way to freedom. And we know if they don't change dance partners, they are going to feel all this stuff. No way around it, no matter what we say. So we need to showcase for them how to, that it's okay to change dance partners. That's it. Very simple. So we take a moment here to gather our energy, strength. This spiritual equation is like a walk-off win. In baseball, the walk-off win is when you're the home team and the game is tied, and you get the winning hit, the winning run in a tie game, like in the ninth inning or extra innings. The Giants have just had two walk-off wins in a row against the Dodgers here. One was in the 10th inning, a Buster Posey home run, and yes, last night was in the ninth inning, a Guillermo Quiroz solo home run, both walk-off wins. So we can have a walk-off win too. Right now, it's like the game is tied. It's going into extra innings. We're the home team. So when we choose this equation, change dance partners, we score a walk-off win, right? Game over. We win. Excuse me. Still a lot of unbelievable pollen and allergies this year. It's just amazing because the severe heat early on just caused everything to go boom all at once. You know, it's more gradual. This is like all at once. Everything had to fruit and flower all at once suddenly. We're kind of like that at this time in the world right now. We all need to flower suddenly. The heat is on. The heat is on. And this affirmation is like heat. It's like putting yourself into a greenhouse where it's very warm, and this will cause you to flower quickly. We need to flower very quickly right now. Yeah, it's no problem. I enjoyed the early summer. It was fantastic. My tomato plants are already 5 feet tall. And they're like Jack and the Beanstalk. I'm kind of worried. I mean, it's a month and a half. I got all of May, June, July, August, and September. I got 5 more months. In fact, they were growing here into October and November last year. So I got 5 or 6 months of more of growth. If they grow 5 feet in 1.5 months, and I've got 5 more months to go, how high are they going to be? Well, 1.5 into 5 is 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, 3.5 times more, so that would be 15 to 18, about 18 feet high. Maybe it'll be about 18 foot high tomato plants. Need a ladder to pick the tomatoes. I need a safari hat going to a jungle. It's going to be an absolute jungle in there. I don't know what they're going to do. What are they going to do? It's just the 5th of May already, for goodness sakes. Well, we'll see. I'll see how high can I get the tomato plants this year. Keep throwing nitrogen on them and see if I can get them to be 18 feet high. That's pretty high. Actually, I don't know how I'd be able to stake them up that high. I'd have to figure out something, right? I'd have to use like deer fencing as cages or something, and double up on it, make it 14 feet high. Double up deer fencing, 14 feet high. Keep the plants from falling. I mean, this wind has knocked some of the branches down, actually. It knocked over pots. It knocked out some flowers, just pulled them right out of the ground. It was some snapdragons. It's unbelievable. Got some powerful winds. And of course, the yard is a complete mess. Again, that means a lot of work to clean it up. It's terrible. Get it all good, and then a week later, it's all messy again. That's the story of my life. I've literally been cleaning this yard up my whole life, about once a week, just because it just gets all completely messed up. And if you let it go, then it gets worse and worse and worse. It's like the house on your block that the tenants are gone and nobody's there, and the yard just goes terrible, and it's an eyesore, right? You don't want that. Well, there's some law of like, or blight, or some blighted property, you can get fined or something. So, everybody here, they keep up appearances of, that your yard is looking neat. So that all falls on my back. So I most definitely want to go somewhere where there's none of this junk. Don't have to clean up everything. If you think it's difficult to clean up the inside of a house, try cleaning up the whole outside. At least inside, you can keep the doors and windows shut. Man, what a mess. And all it takes is here, you get a hot spell, then you get the sudden shift of pressure systems, and the Pacific Ocean's right there, and in comes the cold air, and it's just mighty winds come up, and like a huge air conditioner, and everything changes just like that. And why are they using a leaf blower today? There's the wind is still going. It's not very smart to use a leaf blower today. Because the way the wind is going, it's going to be all messed up tomorrow. I mean, if you're going to clean, wait until the pressure gradients stabilize, equalize. I'm not going to clean today. Things will settle down, and the weather pattern will stabilize, and then the wind will settle down, and then that's when you clean up. However, there might be a reason. Sometimes you need to do that. Maybe you're having a party. If you're having a party tonight, for instance, then you use a leaf blower. I assume that's what they're doing. So there's exceptions to things. So if let's say we're having a big party and we want the place to look great, then you have to clean up, even if the wind is blowing. Clean everything up, and when the guests arrive, it'll look beautiful and sparkling and clean. And then when they leave, it'll still be okay. And then tomorrow, it'll probably look terrible again. But yes, that's okay. So in this world, we cannot wait for the waves to stop. If we wait to go swimming, if we say, "Well, I'm going to go swim, but I'm going to wait till all the waves stop," we'll never go swimming. Or if we say, "Well, I'm going to wait to wash my car until the weather turns good," maybe the weather stays bad, we never wash our car, it looks terrible. We're going to wait for all the wind to die down before we clean up. Well, maybe the wind will keep blowing for a long time. And if we have a need to clean up, then we should do it. So we do have a need right now to change dance partners from time. So we should do it. We cannot wait until everything is great in the world. Everything is not going to be great in the world for quite some time, and maybe never again here on this planet, at least in this cycle. Wow. Heavy leaf blower action. My gosh. So we can't wait. We can't wait. We can't say, "Well, let's wait till everything settles down." Probably will not settle down here in this world. Not in any foreseeable future here in this world is it things are going to settle down anymore. We're in it. We're in the tribulation period. So, let us clean up best we can. Let us change dance partners. We absolutely have to do that now. Now, sure, it's difficult when all this stuff is happening. But again, we can't wait. We can't wait. And sometimes when things are toughest, that's when we can get going the best. Sometimes, like when your yard is really messed up, that gets you to get the leaf blower out, right? Where if it's not so bad, you say, ah, wait another month, or, you know, it's not so bad. But I'm looking right now and it's just terrible. So it's obvious I need to do something. So right now in the world, it's like your yard is just absolutely trashed from the wind. I mean, it's just all these stuff is falling from springtime, all these little fuzzy stuff from the trees, all this stuff's dropping everywhere. There's leaves everywhere from last winter getting blown around with. There's just rain cones everywhere. Just junk. Trees are dropping stuff all over the place. Horrible. That's like civilization right now. Everything that's happening is just terrible. And so you realize, hey, this is just junky. This is terrible. I got to do something. I really have to clean up now. Yeah. I'll probably do it. This is Sunday. I'm not going to do it Sunday evening, even though somebody is. but I could. Anyway, the principle is the same. Is you see, it's so trashed. You say, I got to do something about it. I just can't wait anymore. So that's good. That's really good. It's actually a great time because you should realize, hey, wait a minute. Things are getting irreversibly terrible here. So we need to, you know, get our act together and exchange dance partners. Stop dancing with time. Now, of course, time will always bring up times like some severe wind. It's always going to bring disaster and terrible stuff with it. But again, we don't have to keep dancing with time. We do not have to keep dancing with time. And we're all tired of cleaning up for time, aren't we? Constantly cleaning up for time. Time is constantly dancing this dance of destruction, and we have to constantly be rebuilding, cleaning up from the destruction, rebuilding, cleaning up, rebuild, clean up, rebuild, reboot, you know. Very tiresome. We're very tired of dancing with time, and we don't have to dance with time any longer. Continuity problem can be solved. Use the equation, and you're good to go. And don't be afraid of any situation that arises, because it's all perfectly grist for your mill of your spiritual equation. Just say, oh, great, this is happening. Okay, let me plug this in. This form of temporary loss we call the suspension of our freedoms is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. All right, and you say, oh, good. Practice that. This form of gradual loss that we call loss of privacy is in no way causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. Now, your friends will probably be amazed. You say, you're not upset about all this stuff? Like, wow, you seem kind of calm these days. What's going on with you? Because generally, like the hot-headed people have hot-headed friends, you see. And when you start calming down, you know, you say, well, I'm not hot-headed anymore. They'll say, What's the matter with you? And maybe you'll lose your friends too. It's possible, but that's not so bad, because all friends of truth are your friends, actually. And when you're a friend of truth, truth is a friend to you. And you will feel this inner friendship with truth itself, with safety itself. You see, this leaves are like events taking place in the world. This leaf is like an event taking place in the world. There's all these events taking place as the turmoil in the world happens. There's all these people losing their mind, and the legal and judicial system in the United States and around the world is just going completely crazy. losing their marbles. And nobody's, you know, everybody just shrugging and looking the other way and people reacting, all this stuff. So this leaf keeps going in front of us, but we can say, this form of gradual loss we call a leaf cutting in front of the camera is not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. See, it's not causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of loss, gradual loss right now. It's not disturbing me at all. I see it going, it's okay, it's not, I'm still here. Just because it's cutting in front of the camera doesn't mean I'm not still here. And the broadcast is still going. It's not cutting in front of the audio, is it? It's not cutting out the audio at all. So, no worries. It does cause the... focus to kind of get zapped a little bit, doesn't it? So, yeah, as the leaf cuts across, it causes the focus to get zapped. So I changed it there. So now the leaf will appear to be blurred, and I'll stay in focus. That's good. You see there? Yeah. All right. Very great. And now we're just spending time with this so you can realize there's no problem. There's no sudden, abrupt changes. You don't get catapulted into anything. Just 1 minute, please. Just 1 minute. All right. See, that's not affecting the focus right now. All right, very good. There's no one catapulted into anything. You're just sauntering across a bridge, that's all. There's no huge changes or shifts or anything like that. I've never experienced any such thing. As far as a huge shift or a huge change or anything like that. It's just been a gradual, subtle tweaking of the way I look at things. But people are very reactive. They want something big they can react to. So they may want like some huge shift into bliss so they can react to this huge shift into bliss. No, I don't need to react to it like that. Just remain calm. And we can say, these forms of gradual loss that we call change in no way are causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. We can just simply state that or be aware of it. Say, all this stuff, this dance of gradual loss in no way is causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. That's all that's really necessary. Just be aware of that. All right, well, I'm going to go to the experience of this world that people call the Catholic Mass. And so I observe it all and take it all in and realize that these forms of gradual loss that we call the Catholic Mass in no way causes my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. You see? Anything else? Anything and everything is grist for the mill. Last time we went, the bishop was there, so I could say, this form of gradual loss we call a bishop in no way causes my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. See? No judgment, nothing, just saying it's just not causing me to my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. And this activity, this form of gradual loss we call the activity of confirmation does not cause my spirit to feel in the slightest bit any gradual loss right now. Etc., etc., etc. You see how you can stay centered in this equation? Just be centered in this equation. This is your center. This is your new dance partner. All right, so meet your new dance partner. It's not me, it's this equation. All right. It's like a coach, the running coach. Just here's your track. That's what you're running on. I'm just there to cheer you on and hold a stopwatch. But you're the one who's doing the running. You have to run around the track. It's the track is your running ground. So I'm just here to hold a stopwatch as it is. Just, urging you, showing you, reassuring you, everything's it's fine. This is the new dance partner. So let's dance with this new dance partner and share our experiences with the new dance partner, really. Hello, which way do I go to? There you go. Share experiences with a new dance partner. No longer dancing with time, dancing with the spiritual equation of affirmation. Plug and pave the way to bliss. Plug and play the way to bliss. Nice and smooth, solving the continuity problem right here, right now. And these forms of gradual loss we call the world in no way is causing my spirit to feel the slightest bit of gradual loss right now. All right, dance with the new dance partner, spiritual equations, and keep on dancing. That's it.